and welcome to the first ever episode of Swim Chat. We're going to be connecting swimmers, former coaches, and coaches to talk about their memories, what they're up to now, and get to know them a little better. So I am your host, Nathan White, Senior Manager of Communications for Swimming Canada. And we have a great duo lined up for our pilot episode here today. First of all, she was a member of Team Canada for the London 2012 Olympic Games. Made the team in one of the most memorable Olympic trials moments of all time, or at least in recent memory. And she's now a labor and delivery nurse at Mount Sinai Hospital in Toronto. Heather McLean, welcome, Heather.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Glad to have you. And also joining us, we've got Heather's former coach who helped her make that team. He's Swimming Canada's head coach at the High Performance Center Vancouver, based at the University of British Columbia. We joke on the national team, he's been to every Olympic Games since the first ones in Greece, but I think it's actually everyone since 1976, if I have it right, up through Rio 2016 and into last year's World Championships in Gwangju, South Korea. So I believe it's 10 Olympic Games, 15 World Championships. He's coached people like Heather, Brent Hayden, Marianne Limpert, Emily Overholt, Marcus Thormeyer, and the list goes on. Member of the British Columbia Sports Hall of Fame. And if he ever retires, I think we'll see him in a few more halls of fame. Mr. Tom Johnson. Welcome, Tom.
Thanks, guys. Nice to be here. Definitely experienced, you know, as everybody has, the highs and lows associated with the postponement of the Olympics and the cancellation of the Olympic trials and, you know, the rebooting of all your planning and processing that you have, you know, that was coming to a very, very exciting denouement into the trials that we never really got to. We were within 15 days of it to only have that stop. So, you know, to reboot and do everything has been pretty challenging, but also really interesting. And I'm very, I would say, proud of how I think my group has handled it and the people around me and Swimming Canada and, you know, couldn't be better, really, under what are really trying circumstances.
Yeah, that's awesome. Tom, did you guys, like, what do you do, like, every day now? Are you connecting with the swimmers? Like, how is it working?
Well, every Monday, we start the week with a call, a Zoom call like this.
Yeah.
And it's really, we have a structured dry land program that we implemented right at the get-go. One day is basically circuit type work. One day is strength work and body weight work, particularly at the beginning because didn't have any equipment. We were just one day we were at the pool and the next day we weren't.
Right.
Then the third day is yoga and recovery and that kind of stuff. And we cycle around over a 6 day week like that with the normal Saturday afternoon, Sunday off.
Right.
We're only working once a day.
Right.
But gradually over the period of time that we've been out of the water, people have figured out innovative ways to stay interested and motivated. And, you know, we're using the Peloton Zoom and we're using, you know, the IST group that we have in Vancouver and around the country to specifically address some of the weaknesses and some of the sort of things that, you know, if you were, the words I had to the athletes were, if you had a chance to do this over, what would you do differently? And some of them, you know, have embraced that idea really well. And often, and most of the time, we never get the do-over, you know? And so this has been pretty unique opportunity. And for those of them who have embraced it, it's an opportunity to get better and to use this time well.
In 2010, when I was, you know, not in the best mental capacity that I could have been in. And I took 5 months off swimming.
Yeah.
And how I've been telling swimmers that I've been talking to through head-to-head programs and stuff, how me taking that 5 months off swimming was the best thing I ever did. And how I was able to work on, like you were saying, my mental training and, you know, working with the sports psychologists and working on getting fit out of the water in other ways, and how I think had I not taken that time, I might not have, you know, got back on the track that I needed to get on. And so I hope that, I mean, obviously I can't imagine 15 days out of Olympic trials, it all coming, you know, everything having to change, but I hope that the swimmers can at least try to see the positives that are going to maybe come out of this. But I'm sure, I can't imagine how it just like came crashing down so quickly and all their mindsets would have had to change. When I took that time, I like to say like I worked on something that I'd never worked on before. And that was one, my mental health, but also just like trying to find my love for the sport again. And I had lost that passion. I wasn't having fun. Like it got to the point where I couldn't get myself in the water. I remember sitting on the pool deck for practice one day and I physically couldn't get in the water. And you said to me, you're done. We're done. We're not doing this anymore. We need to get you better. And it took, you know, a lot to get to that point and realize that that was what I needed to do. And then spent a lot of time talking to Whitney, who at the time was our sports psychologist, a lot of time talking to you, a lot of time talking to my parents. And just like a lot of time, it was a step back that I needed to make me realize, okay, what do I love about this sport? What do I need to do to reach the next level? And just worked on myself and worked on, you know, being mindful, practicing yoga, being present, working on that mental game. And I think then when I did end up making the Olympic team in 2012, yes, it was amazing reaching this lifelong goal, but it was also like, I think I was more proud about the journey that I had been on to get there and how I had overcome these obstacles and overcome this 5-month break and overcome all these things to finally get myself back into where I needed to be. And so it was, I mean, with a lot of help from you and a lot of help from my teammates and other coaches and other members of the IST team, but we did it. And I think, I hope that, you know, the swimmers now, even though it's a little bit of a different story, they can at least, you know, see that this break may, as much as in swimming, it seems like a long, long time, that hopefully they'll be able to come back stronger than ever for next year.
Yeah, and I think, you know, perspective is a huge thing, you know, and when you gain that perspective and you gain your rhythm back, like sometimes these unintended breaks or interruptions help you to appreciate things that maybe you lose sight of, right? And one of the things for us that I'm most proud of the swimmers that I'm working with is their self-reliance, their accountability, and their responsibility for doing stuff. And, you know, often you get into like the fix me mode, you know, right. Please fix me. And whether it's, you know, my own kids or, you know, the swimmers who are looking for, you know, the magic sort of answer. And really the answer is within. Right. And when we can get that to that place, either as coaches or as athletes or as administrators, we're way, way better. And I think our country is way better as a result of all of the work that we've done over the last, you know, 10 years or 15 years in the mental health area, and particularly with the people that we have in place right now, that's recognizing that it's okay, right? To be not okay. But there are ways and things that you can do to make yourself, you know, be the best version of yourself every day when you go, right? And so, I mean, you're on the front line, you're on the, you know, taking care of, you know, newborns and just to be borns and all that kind of stuff. It's pretty cool. And so for me to see you happy and doing what you're doing now, right? And making a difference and making a contribution and being able to stand up in the face of all of the challenges, that for me as a coach is something that, you know, we all hope for as coaches, because it's more than just playing tag with the wall and, you know, look up at the clock and see what my time was.
Right.
It's the ultimate thing, but the journey, as you just said, is really what it's all about. And when you can go through that process and then take those lessons and take those challenges and disappointments and make them part of who you are and then be able to help other people, this is a true success story, right, in my mind.
Yeah. So, well, I couldn't have done it without you, that's for sure.
Well, all of us together, right? Hear about people who, you know, take a break and have children and come back and swim faster than they've ever swum before. Or similarly, like, you know, Brandt or Phelps or any of these different people who have time down or time off and they come back and they can swim, you can still swim. And I read this book that Whitney Sedgwick gave me, which was about training older athletes, right? And, you know, it's about Jaromir Jagr playing hockey at 44 years old. And, you know, these people continuing to perform into their 30s, and Tom Brady and different people like that who are excelling in what they're doing. So
I heard about him wanting to come back when we were in Gwangju in Korea on like July 20th or 21st. And John Atkinson says, I just got an email from Brent saying that he's resubmitted his papers for, you know, to become in the doping pool and everything. I went, wow, that's pretty interesting. And he was in Lebanon still at that point in time. So anyway, that story is fairly well known, but I made him come on deck when he first came back, and, you know, we started back pretty, he was ready to go in like end of August and we were starting in September. It's a long year, Olympic year. Right. And so we're going, okay, before you get in, you need to tell everybody why you're doing what you're doing.
Yeah.
And it was pretty cool because he came back really for the love of the sport and for, you know, the challenge that he wanted to see how fast he could swim at this point in time, because he was feeling really good in the water and everything. And he went all the way forward, and, you know, the weekend before the everything shut down, he swam under the FINA A cut and
I know,
finished third at the Grand Prix meet, and, you know, was out swimming Caleb at the end of his 50, and right back to the same thing all over again with his start not necessarily being where it needs to be. But age is only a number, right? And this downtime is only a few pages in a 1,000-page novel. And, you know, sometimes you skip a page and you start reading and you can still remember what the story was. I think the attention span's a lot shorter, right? I think the willingness to work for a longer term goal is sometimes lost on the generations that are coming up. Although it's something that I think we need to work harder on developing in the athlete that was there more readily earlier in my coaching career, that was something that people accepted as being the norm. And I think now with the generation that we're dealing with, and, you know, more recently anyway, that the expectation is that they want the result, and everybody wants a result yesterday, you know, and they to put aside the short-term result for a long-term gain is something that is having to be developed in the athletes to a much greater degree than I think in the past. And it does, it's environmental, it's basically conditional in some ways on, you know, the environment that the kid grew up in and how the parents have raised their kids. But, you know, there is this instant, you know, you've got a three-year-old granddaughter and grandson who has a tablet, you know, and they can sweep, and they, you know, if they don't get their movie right away, they're getting mad, right? And so it's kind of like that. And yet your kids are, my kids are now parents. It's interesting to see them be parents and how they deal with that. And I think that part of what the other thing that's really different is the length of the relationship, you know, where earlier on it was like 3 to 5 years. And if they made it through 2 Olympic cycles, it was amazing. And now you're in, you know, 2 and 3 and 4 Olympic cycles. And with Hayden, it's like, you know, what? We're back. It's 5 Olympic cycles, right? But it's really, you know, one of the things and the benefits of this whole Zoom thing is that, well, you know, not only do we have the weekly call on Mondays, but we also have the Swimming Canada calls, and we have I have the individual calls with the athletes that I try and touch faces with each of those athletes anywhere from once a week to once every 10 days. But the conversation isn't just about swimming. It's about a lot of other things that are going on and in their lives. And I feel like there's a deepening of that relationship that maybe wouldn't exist if you were just on the deck of the pool and they're finished practice and have to go to class and then have, you know, other obligations and life forces that are working. They have time, right? And so like Marion and I are spending time with each other way more than we ever did in our lives as, you know, husband and wife, because I'm not at the pool 5 or 6 hours a day. I'm at home. She probably wants to get rid of me. But, you know, the thing is that we're actually having a great time and we're enjoying each other's company and we're doing stuff and we're keeping ourselves busy. And I think that that's something that people are going to benefit from this, because they're going to learn how to have interests outside of just what they were doing, you know, and they're going to have to find ways to keep themselves busy and to stay well, right, mentally and physically. Right? So.
Yeah, it's a challenge for sure. But it's awesome to hear too that you've been, you know, having those individual conversations with the swimmers too, because I know, I mean, I think as a coach, you know, you cared about us way more than just our performance in the pool. And so to, you know, make sure that you're following up with your athletes, like on a close basis, I know they appreciate it. I'm sure they appreciate it. Cause it, you become, our coaches become such a big part of our lives. Right. And so to take that big piece away is hard. So it's good that you're still, you know, able to connect with them.
Well, I mean, my condolences with, in respect to Kevin and his passing, and like, oh my God, like I was in shock.
I think, you know, we all were. I was actually at work and I had gotten a call from another old swim coach, Chris Bell, and I had missed the call. I was at work and then my mom called me 5 minutes later and I kind of was like, my mom would never call me. She knows I'm at work. So I was like, something is weird. Yeah. And I just remember thinking like, oh my goodness, Lynn, like really a sense of shock, and spent a few days, you know, going through a bunch of old pictures and, you know, talking with Brittany about all the times that we had shared with Kevin. And, you know, I feel so lucky to have been able to, well, that we lived 5 minutes from the Olympium where we, you know, had access to his amazing, not just coaching style, like what he built at the Etobicoke Swim Club, but just he just had such a swimming brain, I guess. And we got to use that. And I think both Brittany and I are forever grateful for what he gave us in this sport, as it, you know, led us to, you know, me to you and her to Georgia. And I think he really fostered a lot of skills in us, you know, hard work. We worked real hard with him, and just a sense of team. And when we were swimming at Etobicoke, we had something, you know, a sense of team that was so special. And I think I was lucky to then carry that to what we had at HBC Vancouver and also to the Thunderbirds. And so, it was definitely a bit of a shock, and the swimming worlds and swim deck will miss him. And I don't normally go for a swim anymore. I hardly ever swim. But after he passed, I said to Brittany, like, I really just want to go for a swim right now. And unfortunately, like, the pools are closed and we haven't been able to do that yet. But as soon as the pools are back open, Brittany and I will go for a swim in his honor, and just, you know, be thankful for the times we did have for him with him. And hopefully, you know, he's in a better place now, and we will he'll be watching over the pool deck for sure for all the next swimming generations. So
for sure. We had a get together on Zoom exactly like this, right? And just before I lose the thought, one of the things about this is that you actually see the person's face, right?
Right.
And so you have a sense, and you know a lot of what I do is being able to read, you know, in your eyes, in your face, in your body language, you know, like, how are you, right? And how are things going? And that influences my coaching every day, right?
Right.
And so, but with Kevin was, you know, I roomed with him in Rio, right?
Right.
So we were there, and he worked for me for a year in Vancouver before he went to Winnipeg and then subsequently to Toronto. And Ron Madison also roomed with him in London.
Right.
And so there was a connection there. So it was Ron Madison, myself, my assistant right now, Ben Keast, Graham Olson, who knew Kevin from all the video stuff and everything he did. So we had a Zoom, and we got Dave involved and a bunch of other coaches, and we had a toast for Kevin, right? So it was really fun. And just old Kevin stories, you know? So
yeah, we did the same because so Kevin loves Starbucks, like loves.
Yeah,
Starbucks.
Yeah.
And he would get a quad espresso, like numerous times a day, he would have a quad espresso. So the day after he passed, Brittany was like, okay, well, we have to track down Starbucks. Like, we need to get Starbucks and have a little picnic on the front lawn and tell Kevin stories. So my mom literally drove around for half an hour trying to find a Starbucks drive-through. She was unsuccessful. So I said, okay, I know where there's one. So we drove 10 minutes to this Starbucks drive-through. We waited in line for 40 minutes. We finally got our Starbucks, our quad espresso at our thing. And we're driving to the Starbucks, and then we see this huge line. And my fiance Jordan says to me, well, like, can we not just go get McDonald's coffee? I was like, no, it has to be Starbucks. So we got our Starbucks and we did the same thing. We had a toast to Kevin with a quad espresso. We didn't drink the quad espresso, but we bought one for him anyway. So we had a little nice moment.
Ron says that, you know, Kevin liked single malt scotch, which was Lagavulin. And right. Mike Blondell was on this call.
Okay. Right?
And so he had gone to Etobicoke's or to Kevin's house, you know, because a lot of swimmers from Etobicoke make their way out to Calgary and,
right.
you know, yeah. whatever. So they were, you know, in appreciation for it, he brought him, you know, a Lagavulin, right? A bottle. And so he goes into the basement and the Lagavulin is up on the shelf. And he goes, you don't drink that. He says, oh, I don't drink it. I just collect it. And Ron remembered. So we all went out and he and I bought like a bottle of Lagavulin and we had toast in Kevin's honor, right? So it was total fun, right?
Yeah, that's
and good memories. And it's you know, devastating loss for Etobicoke and for the swimming community in Canada. But like you say, hopefully he's in a better place and we'll miss him. Right?
We will definitely miss him. I can remember just knowing that I could do it. I knew I had the capability of doing it, but was just like, could I overcome the mental game that I was playing with myself? And I remember sitting with Whitney, who was our sports psychologist, literally on the pool deck, and we just practiced mindfulness activities to keep me kind of in the moment and not kind of spiral into this mess. And I just got up on the blocks and swam the race that I knew I needed to swim and got my hand on the wall and, you know, was there to celebrate with my sister and afterwards celebrating with Tom and my family and then getting, you know, to go to the games and Tom being there and being able to experience all of that together, even though, you know, my performance at the Olympics was not necessarily what we had planned or hoped for or wanted, but it was obviously very exciting and a time that I still remember vividly, and it feels like yesterday. 8 years ago feels like yesterday, but and it's fun. I now, you know, get to share. So my parents made us Brittany and I it was like a video. It was like a 25-minute video of all good luck from all of our friends and family for leading up to Rio. And we watched it when we were on staging camp in Italy. She sent it to us. We had no idea. It was like all of our different friends and family. So the other day, I don't know why it came up, but it came up in our conversation. And so we watched it and just sharing it with Jordan and trying to share with Jordan now kind of my swimming career and bringing up all those emotions and trying to explain to him like what it was like and all that stuff. It's you really can't put words to it is what I've really realized. You really can't describe the feelings and emotions, but it was a special time, let's just say.
Just remember one thing, it's never over.
Never over till it's over.
Thanks again for doing this, and thanks to everyone who's watching or listening this, and let us know if you have any thoughts, either comment, review, send us an email at nwhite@swimming.ca and let us know what you would like to see more of. We may not be in the pool right now, but we have a lot of members of our community with a lot of interesting stories to tell. And I just want to say thanks once again to our guests today, Heather McLean and Tom Johnson. Thanks for doing this.
Thank you. Great.